Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. Let Grace Lowerstone Reformed Church say, his love endures forever. Good morning.
Good morning.
I've got a number of announcements, and once I'm through, or if you have an announcement, start to make your way up here to make it from this mic. But next Sunday, we will have our first Sunday luncheon, and next Sunday, it's sponsored by the youth. So plan on staying after church next week and having a nice meal. The menu is mentioned in the bulletin. And I wanted to mention that the Women's Guild is soliciting recipes. So Candy Broadway, I think, has some forms. So you can submit a recipe, and they're hoping to have a cookbook, Grace Lowerstone Reformed Church cookbook, prepared by the time the bazaar rolls around, right? And so they are in need of recipes, and I've even given them one, right? I think it's going to possibly be put in print. I know. Let's see here. In church and ministry, we had talked about confirmation, David, and I wanted to put it out there. We talked about it this morning at consistory. If there are young people who have not been confirmed, who would like to get confirmed, we will firm up something for probably during Lent, confirmation class. We'll put it in the bulletin and we'll put it in the newsletter, but maybe we could do something Sunday morning. There are several options, so please let me know, and we will publish this more to solicit interest. And then this week we're actually moving into Lent. Ash Wednesday is March the 1st, and we will have a joint service with Boger, where we'll meet over there at Boger at 6:30, and I'll give a little meditation, and I'll do something with Pastor Chad. And then next Sunday is the first Lenten service at 6 o'clock, and that service is going to be at Mount Hope. And on the schedule, I am down for giving the message, but there was a scheduling change that happened after we had published this, and I'm swapping with Pastor Myers, who can't preach on the day that he was supposed to preach. So, but anyway, the location is the same, and I'll be there, and I hope you can be there. And Eddie, tell Joni we said happy birthday today, okay? Let's see. I think that's all that I had to mention. Is there anything else?
As you can see, the flu has taken a toll on the congregation this week, and also on the choir. So we are not doing the song that's in the bulletin. We're going to be doing Because He Lives today.
Anything else? All right, then. Well, let us begin worship with a choral intro on page 209, and the words for the verse that we'll sing are in our bulletin. So let us rise. Happy are those who walk in God's ways.
Blessed are those who observe God's commandments.
Faithful are those whose eyes are fixed on righteousness.
Joyful are those whose hearts are filled with praise.
Come, let us love the Lord our God.
We come to worship the one who leads us in the ways of life.
And our opening hymn is Be Thou My Vision on page 562. Let us pray. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. And we lift up our hearts, the gates of our hearts, to you, Lord. And we ask you to come into our hearts and in our sanctuary as we worship you and praise you, and as we pray together the prayer that you gave to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And you may be seated, please. Thank you. I would like to ask the deacons to come forward as I read the invitation to offering. God's glory is far greater than we can describe. We praise and worship Him today as we do every Sunday. As we approach this upcoming holy season, please help us to listen closely to the Word and Spirit. Soften our hearts so that our church's witness may contribute to more people, helping us to draw them and us closer to God in our faith. Help us commit ourselves anew to God's service through our gifts and offerings today and our offertory as we are so blessed on page 795. Let us pray. Lord, you gave yourself for us, and we give something back to you this morning. Please receive these offerings as a token of our worship, as a token of our thanksgiving, and bless these offerings in this church, and bless the hearts that have given these. We pray these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And you may be seated. And this morning, let's see, for children's message, we're going to talk about Hawaii, maybe?
Right.
So come on forward. Hey, how are you?
Good deal.
Well, you know what? You must have read my mind or something. I'm going to speak about Hawaii.
I think most people know that we went to, Don and I went to Hawaii for the last, I guess, 10 days or so. And it is a beautiful, beautiful place. But even more than what you can see is beautiful is that the people are really great. They have what they call the aloha spirit. Do you know what aloha means? You ever heard that word before? Aloha? Well, it's a Hawaiian word, and it means hello, and it means goodbye, and it means love. And it's a love with no obligation, not expecting anything in return. So it's I love you no matter what you do. The people there are just so wonderful. They seem to love everybody. You're constantly greeted with aloha, and they'll go like that and say aloha. And what that is I guess it's hang loose or take it easy, but they'll say aloha.
They're not from Texas, right?
They're not from Texas. No, it's not a longhorn steer. It is just a wonderful place to visit. We saw people from Japan. And you know what? Japan is as close to Hawaii as San Francisco is. So even other countries are as close as we are to Hawaii. It's out in the middle of the ocean. I used to tell people, you know, where we live, you go out to the middle of nowhere, turn right, go 300 feet, and you'll find our house. Well, this is even further out in the middle of nowhere than we are. Two words that you hear a lot. You hear aloha, which is hello and goodbye and love. And the other word you hear is mahalo, and that's thank you. So can you repeat that? Can you say aloha? Can you? No? Okay. All right. You know, we take a lot of pride in Southern hospitality, but there is a huge, huge, I don't know what it plays, I don't know what it's called, but love, a huge amount of love there in Hawaii. It's just, everybody loves each other, and you see all different kinds of people. You see people from foreign countries like Germany, from Japan, from all around the world, and they all seem to get along just great. One thing they do have, they've got a state fish, and that is humu humu nukunu kapanua. That's a word about that long. It's huge. And all it is really is just a trigger fish, but they have to have a huge Hawaiian word for it. So when you think about Hawaii, don't think about just how pretty it is, but think how wonderful it is, how the people's attitude is. It's just one of love and one of taking care of each other. Okay? So let's pray. Okay? Father, we just thank you for the chance to go to other places and to see other people and to get a small picture of what it's like in other countries, to enjoy the love and all that it brings. Father, we just ask that we would be able to show that to others, even here and as we live here, show that same love to all that we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Or mahalo.
All right, well, we'll move into pastoral prayer, and let me mention some items that, and I'll take some items from everyone that's appropriate for today. And the flu was mentioned earlier on, that we do have a lot of people who are out with the flu, and I do know of some, Wayne, for example, Bost, he's got some situations going on with him, and he doesn't even want to risk coming around people with the flu. So we'll pray for God's help and healing in that whole department. And then I got a request from Linda Hand for a dear friend of hers that she would like for us to hold up in prayer, and that's Myra Parnell, who has had who's suffering from cancer, and Sharon Goodson, our sister in Christ. Her family's had such troubles this past week, and I think a nephew had some surgery, and so we'll sort of remember Sharon and her family. And those are the items that I have, and I'll take some more prayer requests. So are there other prayer requests for today? Others?
Steve?
Yes.
My first member, Bob and Bob. Bob Boss, Bob Rimmage, along with Wayne.
Okay. And, you know, I mentioned the flu, and I know that, Actually, Rhonda had it, her family had it, and I'm not sure how Martha's doing, but I think she had it last week, and so I don't know if she gave it to Alton, but anyway. Other requests?
Steve, I forgot something too. Along with Bob and Wayne, we need to remember Becky and Donna and Abbott.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Jay. Anything else? All right, then. Well, let us pray. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? And we lift up our eyes to you, Lord, for you are our help. You are our salvation, and you are our healer and helper. And Lord, we praise you and thank you because you do watch over us. Even when things are not going our way, you have, our lives are in the palm of your hand. So Lord, we come to you with all of our needs, spiritual and physical. We ask, Lord, that you would bless our church. And that you would be with all of our members who are present or absent. We have many who have been ill because of the flu or other things going on. And we pray, Lord, that your healing hand would be upon us. That you would help those who are not doing well and strengthen them and heal them. We pray, Lord, for every single soul associated with our church. That you would bless them with all spiritual blessings through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Fill us with faith, hope, and love. The journey is hard to take, and we don't know the way. So we ask, Lord Jesus, to show us the way. We pray that you would help us. Lord, we remember especially some people who are in need of healing or intervention, and we remember our sister in Christ, Sharon Goodson, and her family, her mom and dad, and her nephew, and we pray, Lord, you would heal and help her and her family. We pray for Myra Parnell, who is seriously ill with cancer. We pray for Mike Newberry, who is also seriously ill with cancer. Please heal both of these people. We pray for Bob Bost and his wife, Becky. We remember Wayne Bost and his wife, Avis. And we remember Bob and his wife, Donna. There's sickness and disease touching these dear friends of ours, and we pray, Lord, that you would heal them. Indeed, just say the word, and all of the people we have mentioned will be healed. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us in any special needs that we present to you. And I pause right now for some silent prayer, some special requests to be given to you. Lord, we're about to move into the period of Lent, and we pray that you would help us and inspire us to take a Lenten journey with you, and that you would inspire us to spend a little more time with you and seek your light in our daily lives, not only in Lent but throughout the year. We pray for our country and that you would bless it. We remember our soldiers and those serving in the armed forces who may be in harm's way, and we ask, Lord, you would protect them and bring them home safely. We remember those locally who serve us in some form of uniform, and we pray, Lord, that you would protect them in their activities. We pray, Lord, for families and individuals who are sorrowful over the death of a loved one. We pray for all those who are sick and suffering and for your healing hand. We remember those who are discouraged, and that you would bless them with some hope and optimism. We pray, Lord, for our land, for our country, indeed for the world, that it might produce crops and the food necessary to feed us all. And we pray, Lord, for your hand to be upon our governments and our churches, that we might help distribute those who are less fortunate. So, Lord, we pray for your blessing upon us, that we may be that help to the world that you are to us. And we pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And our hymn of worship is "Open My Eyes That I May See." It's on page 563. Please be seated. And we have two scriptures today, and so let me read the first one. It's Psalm 62 for the director of music, a psalm of David. My soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. How long will you assault a man? Would all of you throw him down this leaning wall, this tottering fence? They fully intend to topple him from his lofty place. They take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. Low-born men are but a breath. The high-born are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together, they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or take pride in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them. One thing God has spoken, two things have I heard, that you, O God, are strong, and that you, O Lord, are loving. Surely you will reward each person according to what he has done. Psalm 62. And our second reading is from the Gospel of Matthew. And this is from chapter 6, verses 24 through 34. And this is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, speaking or being quoted. No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And so let us rise and sing the Gloria Patri. Please be seated. And today we're going to talk about soul stuff. Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. Well, the psalmist is talking to himself. He is telling his soul to find rest in God alone. And we do talk to ourselves. We do have souls. And you know what? The whole Christian experience is about soul stuff. It's about conversations with the soul. If we aren't involved with soul stuff or soul talk, we aren't involved with the Christian experience. Well, for starters, what does the soul even mean in the scriptures? The Hebrew description of the soul is quite broad, and we can talk about lots of stuff, but there are some pertinent meanings that we can talk about today as we talk about soul talk. First, the soul can simply mean desire. It's the desire for stuff like food, clothing, drink. It's the desire for love and affection. Soul is desire. Secondly, the soul, it's not a physical organ. In the ancient scriptures, they didn't look at it as a heart pumping. It was the seat of our center of all spiritual experiences and emotions. So maybe spiritual feelings and emotions, we might say, is what the soul is, a secondary meaning of the soul. And then there's a third meaning that's, and it's hard to describe these things for you, but the third meaning of the soul from the Hebrew, I'm not throwing out a big word here, but I will. It's the vital self. And so what in the world does that mean, Steve? The vital self is that little voice inside that kind of tells us the truth. I don't know about you, but sometimes when we get involved with something, you know, something has an appeal, maybe there's a crowd that we start to associate with, young or old, and then suddenly kind of realize, you know, I don't fit in here. This isn't where I belong. Well, it's the vital self that tells us that kind of thing. So the soul is about our desires. It's about the sort of the center of our spiritual life, and it's that little voice inside, or that vital experience. Well, the Christian experience is about talking with the soul, with these things that I've talked about. We see it in our scripture. Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from Him. So we do talk to our souls. We talk to ourselves. We also get our soul in conversation with the Lord Jesus Christ, with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and with the church. And that's us right here. And if we aren't in conversation, we are not involved with the Christian experience. The whole point of the Christian experience, or one of the major points of the Christian experience, is to bring our souls into the way of Jesus Christ. You know, we are not robots. We just don't do things automatically. And while we are Reformed, the Reformed faith doesn't mean that everything happens according to a mechanized plan. We have choices to make. And so this whole thing of soul talk and soul stuff is about getting involved with the choices that we have to make every day. And this is why it's a journey, and it's also a struggle. You know, sometimes our soul is right where it should be, and sometimes it isn't. And so we talk to our soul. We get our souls in this conversation with Jesus Christ. And we also get involved with our conversation with the church, everybody here. And it goes, it's a two-way thing. So we get influenced, and we also influence others, and we influence our souls. You see what I'm talking about here with this soul talk? Well, I mentioned that the soul can be our desire. We desire all kinds of things. And some of the things that we desire are good, and some of the things we desire aren't so good. And Jesus actually talks about our desires, and He also points out this tension that we can have, a divided soul. And this is what He says in our second scripture that I'm putting into this flow of this soul talk. Jesus says, "No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." Well, in psychology, as our friend Dr. David would say, there is a phenomena or a disorder called schizophrenia. And in that particular case, there are multiple personalities, at least two. And what's happening is you have a tension. You do have divided devotions in effect. It's sort of like that person who tries to love both money and God at the same time. And you know, if you have divided affections, divided desires, you're in turmoil. we've all had that sometimes. You have conflicts, two priorities that just don't really go together. And so we have this this turmoil in our hearts, and we have turmoil in our lives. And you know, part of this is just the whole struggle of the Christian experience, because you know, we say one thing, but we don't do what we say. And so I think part of what Jesus is telling us, or what he's admonishing us, is get your soul centered on the right thing. Make God the real object of your devotion and of who you serve. And so that's something we have to remind ourselves all the time as we do this soul talk, as we do this soul stuff. We want to remind ourselves, do the right thing. Seek the Lord, serve the Lord. Now, the soul is about desire, and desires can be misplaced. So we may desire something that we shouldn't. And, you know, sometimes when we desire things, we can desire them so much and stay so focused on them that we become fearful if we don't get what we desire. And that's what fear is. Fear is the expectation that my hopes will not be realized. And so we worry, and that's part of what goes on with our soul. I think it's connected with our desires. It's a negative form of desire. And Jesus speaks to us about our souls and about these worries that we have. He tells us, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes or houses or mortgages or 401ks? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. In short, Jesus is telling us to talk to our souls and say what the psalmist says to his soul. What do we say to that voice inside, that place inside? Find rest, O my soul, and God alone. My hope comes from him. Well, we can talk to our souls, but we also, in this soul stuff or this soul talk, talk with other people. And we also see it in the psalm. It's sort of a conversation, a dialogue in life. Various conversations go on. The psalmist, notice, if you go back and look at Psalm 62, he speaks to those forces that are troubling him, people or demons or whatever is bothering him. And the psalmist, just like you and me, we have people and demons who bother us and make us worry. And so we have people who want to hurt us. And so what we do is we speak to those forces that are opposed to us. And we can hear how the psalmist does this. He speaks from his soul to the forces around him. He says, how long will you assault a man? Would all of you throw him down, this leaning wall, this tottering fence? They fully intend to topple him from his lofty place. They take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Well, my friends, we know that the word of God is powerful, but our words as well are powerful. We can speak to people, to demons, to those things that we don't want. And we can speak about those forces where we want to correct it. So we can say, you are not what I want to be, when we speak to our soul or to other people, and I rebuke you. And so this can be our person. It can be something in our nature. This could be a spiritual force that's upon me. Soul stuff or soul talk is also about listening. We listen when we are at home reading scripture and when we're with the other saints in the assembly of God. And scripture and the church are always speaking to us, as the psalmist gives us an example. The psalmist says, "Trust in the Lord at all times, O you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. Low-born men are but a breath. The high-born are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or take pride in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them." Well, not only does the psalmist speak to us, but Jesus Christ speaks to our souls. "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." So, my friends, what can we say about all this soul stuff? Our souls can influence us, but we can influence our souls. In the Christian experience, if we are not trying to influence our souls, we are not really involved in the Christian experience. We don't let our desires take over us. We don't let our demons control us. We take an active role in living our Christian life, and it does mean work. We read the scriptures and we pray. We come here and listen, and we also come here and encourage others. And all of this I might call soul stuff or soul talk. We say to our souls what the psalmist says: "Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him." Amen. And our closing hymn today is "Just a Closer Walk with Thee." It's on page 564. So let's rise to sing our closing hymn.
As I walk, let me walk.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind blow at your back. May the rain fall gently on your field. May the sun shine warmly on your face. And until we meet again, may the Lord hold you in the palm of his hand. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be gracious to you and grant you peace. Amen.